So I'm back here with the Mi Notebook Pro, but this time around it's the most powerful version you can get, the i7 one. So it's configured with an Intel 8th generation i7-8550U, maximum turbo of 4 GHz. It's a quad core, so they've really stepped up in terms of power, going from the 7th generation, which were dual cores, to now quad core, which is great to see. And the battery life, the design and everything like that, the sound, I've already covered that in my full review of the i5 model, so there's no point in me repeating all of that, so check out that review if you're after information on that. And it does have 16 gigabytes of RAM, as you can see, which is running in dual channel, according to CPU Z here, and it is running at 2400 megahertz. Now, I got the 16 gigabyte model because I feel for my 4K videos that I edit, it just runs so much smoother, of course, than the 8 gigabytes of RAM on the i5 model. And the GPU is exactly the same as the i5 model, so it's the NVIDIA MX150. So it still has that problem that I encountered with the i5 model, and that is that the PCIe SSD in there, now it ships with a Samsung PM961, which is basically this drive here, which I have installed myself, a Samsung Evo 960. Now the reason behind its speed not being as fast as it could be is this right here. You can see that it says the interface is Gen 3, that's fine, but it's times 2 speed, so not times 4. Now, if it was times 4, then my read speed here on sequentials would be approximately 3000 megabytes per second. The writes would be about the same, and the 4K speeds possibly a little bit faster there, but they are very good anyway. So it's not really going to affect the overall performance, but if you wanted to get your maximum out of your NVMe drive, then you're going to be out of luck here, which is disappointing. Now onto benchmarks. Here with Geekbench 4, you can see it's about 500 points faster on the single core score, and then 2000 points approximately on multi-core score, as expected for the faster clock rate. So 400 more megahertz and 1 megabyte more of cache on the CPU. Here's the score of the i5 version. You see the differences between both of them there. So a nice boost there when it comes to the synthetic benchmarks, at least. Firestrike 1.1. So this is the score of the i5. And then slightly faster here on the i7 version. So this is to be expected because we have the same GPU, which is the bottleneck when it comes to 3D performance or gaming performance. Now, when we take a look at just GPU related benchmarks, so this does not actually use the CPU, there's no real difference to the i5 version. So this is the Heaven benchmark, version number 4, score of 603. This is on the stock clocks. And now when I overclocked the GPU here, you can see that you can increase that score quite a bit. You get almost 6 frames per second on average game there. So I definitely do recommend it if you are going to do a little bit of gaming, even though this isn't a gaming laptop, to at least overclock that GPU. And now we'll take a look at the Cinebench R15 score. So the stock score is around 661, but I've applied my power limit tweak here, and you can see the score is there almost 800 CB, which puts it almost around the same speed as a Core i7-4770K, which is really good considering this is a quad-core notebook 15-watt processor. Now it's time to do that same encoding test I did a video. So 4K video will be encoded here now in Adobe Premiere Pro, with the preset, which is the default one, the YouTube 4K. So I've got 1 minute of footage, the exact same footage I used in my gaming notebook review with the i7-7700HQ. Now that took 3 minutes and 9 seconds to encode 1 minute's worth of footage. And the i5 model, which is the 8250U on this Mi notebook, took 3 minutes and 19 seconds. So let's have a look how much faster the i7 version is going to be, if any. So I'll get this started right now, hit export, and then straight onto that timer. So there we go, it's just about to finish up now. We'll wait until that 100% bar disappears, that means it's completely done. So there we go, 3 minutes and 16 seconds. Not that much faster than the i5 version, which got 3 minutes and 19 seconds. Now I did that 4K video encode with a TDP of 35 watts here, you can see. So the default would be 15, but I have increased it here to boost the performance. So with the stock power limit, it will take approximately 5 minutes to encode 1 minute of 4K video in Adobe Premiere Pro. But you see, doing this speeds it up. You lose, well, you gain about 2 minutes, which is really good. But look at the temperatures here. We did peak up to 90 degrees, so it is getting quite hot there. So I have a dedicated video that will be coming out shortly with gaming on the i7 model with the 16 gigabytes of RAM, just to have a look and see if it does perform a little bit better. But I'll just give you a quick snippet here. So I'm going to test out Battlefield number 1, and this is on 1080p resolution and the lowest graphics quality preset, because let's face it, I mean, on medium or high, it's going to really struggle, this GPU. We'll see how it runs anyway, just to give you a little preview before my gaming review. So there are about 32 players on this server, well, almost, about 31 or something. And you can see that the frame rate, very decent and quite playable. So it's been running now for 1 hour, and I have done some gaming, some benchmarking, some tests. Now I just checked the surface temperature. It's up to 41 degrees at the moment, so that's slightly cooler than the 45 I got on the i5 version. But I think it's to do with the ambient temperature, which is also a couple of degrees less at the moment because we're heading into autumn to winter. So we got up to 66 degrees on the GPU. And if I scroll up here, the CPU maxed out here at 89, but do remember that I've overclocked the GPU and I have also added that power limit. So that's running at the moment at 30 watts, which is double the power limit than stock. I'm currently stress testing the CPU and the GPU at the same time here. Now it's at 100% fan speed and it maxes out around 53 decibels. Temperatures on the CPU at the moment, this is with the stock 15 watts, 71 degrees and 66 degrees on the GPU. I'll give you a sample at the fans now at 100%. So there we go, the 16 gigabytes of RAM is the real reason why I think you should go for this particular model here if you can afford it and if you can get one for a decent price. So the i5 model is great, it still performs well, and the difference between the two really isn't that much. Okay, synthetic benchmarks, they show that they're a lot higher here, but real world use, I've noticed that with 4K encoding there, that it's not really that much faster. So you can push it quite a bit harder when you increase those power limits. But the thing that's got going for it is that 16 gigabytes of RAM. So that will future-proof this device. It means that when I edit 4K videos myself personally, I have noticed that it just feels a little bit smoother when I start to add a lot of different 4K clips there with high bit rates. It just handles it so much better. Multitasking can be pushed a little bit harder. Gaming performance, because of the slightly higher clocks, maybe slightly better. But I'm going to have a review coming out soon of gaming on this i7 model here with the 16 gigabytes of RAM. But it's not that much of a difference because obviously that NVIDIA MX150 is the bottleneck of this system. But this is a great laptop, really do love it. It's got one of the best touchpads you'll find on a Windows laptop. The keyboard as well is excellent. Decent screen on there, 360 lux bright, fully laminated. sRGB coverage of 88%. The build quality is premium. Battery life, if you're just on the integrated graphics and you're doing something light like web browsing, get up to about 9 hours, which is really decent. So overall, it does come recommended by me. And seriously, think about that, the i5 model with the limitation of 8 gigabytes, or this model here then with 16 gigabytes, and just future-proofing it a little more. So if you haven't seen my full review of the i5 model, which covers a lot of detail in regards to that touchpad, the keyboard, the overall design, then please check that one out. And I do hope to see you back in the channel. Bye for now.